So we have an extraordinary firm, extraordinary panel. The format is going to be fairly straightforward. We'll have one round of questions, after which I think Iqbal steps in with being a devil's advocate in a way, and then we have a second round of questions, after which I think we keep it open to the audience in terms of a Q&A. So that's broadly the format of today's session. I'll start off with you, Narendra sir. I mean, you know, we have been speaking of many things in terms of ROIs, RMCs, and things like that. How difficult is it for a medium, and this is a question that, you know, we've been talking to a lot of small and medium-sized print firms, that they have to innovate, and to innovate, they need to add machinery. Machinery is fairly expensive. And then you have pitches, you know, by machine manufacturers about the ROI structure and so on, which are fairly misleading. Sometimes it ends up eating into your profit lines, into your bottom lines, top lines. As someone who has never shied away from investing in the best of equipment at all times, and you know, your own growth path, what is the one advice you would say to ensure that the RMC, ROI is sort of, does not become a parasite to the balance sheet of an organization?
Actually, when I was given the topic, top line or bottom line, nowadays if you see most of the pictures, Hindi pictures, Telugu pictures, there's a tagline for every movie, something and tagline. So the tagline for this, Eko hi puchne ki baat hai. So it is, business is, the goal of business is to make money. And if you're not making money, then the whole point is lost. The point is, I think whether top line, bottom line is not the question at all. Finally, we have to make money to keep it running. And if you really look at your own, how you're investing, whether you're pumping the money back, if you're putting the money, let's say you're buying the raw materials on time, you get a much better price. If you pay after 960 days or 90 days, you get much, much higher. So the margin goes down. So you're keeping running, you're running the things, but you're really not adding anything to your system. You're not making it efficient. So as the various things which we'll heard in the morning, unless you're very, very clear on all those things, your margins will go down. Believe me, in the last time we raised prices for printing, from 100 rupees to 125 rupees for a small format, 1825 or 2026, was in 1996. After that, it never rose. So after 1996, it's always been at 125. But the point is, your own improvement of efficiencies, your own systems, everything, those make the profit. So as they said, it's going down, coming up. How do you make your money? And but you have to make your money. And over the years, replacing machines, getting the efficiencies much higher, that's what has been happening. And I sincerely think, without any doubt, it is bottom line, and we always do that. There are jobs which you do free because we are supporting a cause, but otherwise it has to make money. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. Mr. Jasawala, I know that, you know, since you've come to Thomson and, you know, you've been overseeing operations there, you've cleaned up a lot of things. You have an interesting sort of methodology called the theory of constraints, among other things. And in addition to that, I mean, I know that you've become, you know, try to change the branding for Thomson to become a reliable printer, to be able to compete with a lot of other printers that have come on the scene. But one crucial aspect which had been affecting your top line, bottom line, has been your cost structure internally. I mean, it's a huge, they used to say it is a white elephant once upon a time, very unwieldy to manage. Again, your advice, and you know, you obviously learned certain things, certain tips, if you can, in terms of how do you manage to, A, sort of get the, you know, top line going again, once again, and nullifying your costs.
Okay, thank you. Let me start with one of the biggest, I won't call it a failure, but a wrong decision taken by Thomson. It's just to give an example. We, in 2006-07, we brought the state-of-the-art web printing press called the Gauss 600D. It's the Rolls-Royce in printing. And it was brought at a price of around 35 crores. And it was bought because Thomson presumed that the past is a good indicator of the future. Nothing could be more wrong than this presumption. Because in 2007-08, you know what happened. The markets collapsed. And what we presumed, that Thomson was growing at the rate, in magazine printing, at the rate of some 15% per annum, we should be able to do even better, because why should you be hung up by your past? And on some very relevant grand plans constructed in 2005, we went and placed the order, brought the machine in 2007. And till date, the whole market has changed. It is meant for a long run printing press. But today, market runs in magazine printing is down to 10 to 20, sometimes even less. The cost of operating this for short run printing is vastly different from what we thought it was, etc. At the end of the day, I just want to convey one point to you. Never use the past to take a decision for tomorrow. Always, always. And till the depreciation and interest of this machine will expire over 10 years, we will carry this, you used the term white elephant. Now, fortunately, Thomson is a big company and we can absorb this, we can live with it, but we would have been better off if we had thought about what the market could be, read the had the foresight to understand how the future will be, etc. But foresight is always good in hindsight. We are learning that today. So be careful, don't be carried away. Remember, the market dictates what you will buy and not vendors. I mean nothing against the previous one, but everybody does their job. Be careful. Let the customer dictate. Another problem is printers decide, I know technology, I know what is the machine required, and then they go searching for customers. So when I came into this company, I was shocked. We had presses, we had a complete mismatch between the market, the customer requirement, and the equipment, the sizes, etc. Once again, be very clear, and I'm sure you will do that. Let the customer and the market requirements dictate your options of what you are buying, size, technology, and everything behind it.
Yep.
Coming to this issue, yes, Thomson has been amongst the biggest, it's a very cost-heavy organization. And this was built up in the good old heady days. We were making a lot of money, so we kept on adding costs in machine, in people, in all kinds of overheads. And then suddenly when the market changes, you know, the costs get naked and they start showing up. When revenues come down and the problems suddenly get so exaggerated, you don't know what to do. But these costs, unfortunately, have been built over a decade and more. Trying to address it is not easy. You know, it's basically in people, it's in overheads, it's in equipment that has been bought. And therefore, the challenge for Thomson has always been how to cut our costs in line with what industry and customer will pay and what industry competitors to Thomson have. It's a very simple problem. If the customer gives, say, 150 rupees per impression, if my cost is 70 and somebody else's cost, any other printer, is at 40, he makes 10 rupee profit, I make a 20 rupee loss. It's as bad as that. So the biggest issue for Thomson has been, for me, for the last several years, is to actually not just grow revenues, which is absolutely important, but a much bigger one, to rationalize costs, to restructure the organization, to look at penny pinching everywhere without hurting quality and without hurting on-time delivery. So we've been on that, and I'll take it further if you
wish. Sure. Nilesh, a question for you. I mean, this was a presentation that one had heard from your, you know, the head of Vistaprint, and he was talking of something quite interesting, that his customer is the person whose annual spend on print is only 5,000 rupees, and that is the market that you're targeting, which obviously seems very unviable for a lot of the traditional printers who are seated here. You're obviously disrupting something in a big way. You have a very cool front end for your website and so on and so forth. But ultimately, the economics of it, I mean, is it is it something that is monetizable, A? And then B, what are the possibilities in a, you know, country like India with that sort of a model where you're looking at an annual spend of 5,000 per print?
Yeah, well, let me start off with, how did this idea evolve? Why did Vistaprint start this business? Why did I start this business, which was called Printbell 5 years ago, which got acquired by Vistaprint? I think what we are thinking of as a vision is, if you think about the early centuries of humanhood, you had your local carpenters, your plumbers, your artisans who would make products that you want, right? It was slow, it was manual, it was what you wanted, but you had to make a lot of compromises. And then about a century or two ago, there was this massive industrial revolution which said, hey, if we were to mass produce things, we can get you a much wider choice, and we can get you great quality. So today when you walk into a retail store, you get any number of sizes and colors for any t-shirt or any other product you want to buy. I think what we are banking on as Vistaprint is that the next evolution for this this cycle would be customers would still want that wide variety, they would want that basket, but they would want something of their own as a reflection on that product. And that was the basic idea behind the model of Vistaprint or Printbell. And you talked about margins. I think, you know, for us, and we are a public company, so I can say this openly, our gross margins today are still north of 65%. 65%. And the way we produce these products, I mean, just this past holiday season in one of our plants in Europe, we were able to ship out more than 1 lakh unique orders in a single day. So I think what we've been able to achieve is mass customization at scale, which I think is the bridge that you have to cross to marry the price with the high quality. And I think that's really the juice of the business.
Sure. Thanks, Nilesh. Dharti, I mean, you know, the rise and sort of journey and trajectory of mail order solutions has been phenomenal. Again, a very interesting business model, very akin to Vistaprint, of course, in a very different and total space. One of the things has been that you've held on to this core group of about 15 to 20 customers, which now I think you've expanded. But the other really interesting thing in the last 2 years or 3 years has been a really sort of breakneck speed at which you've been investing in terms of adding machinery, and at a time when some of your other competitors have slowed down and so on. A, what's the justification for that? And then B, in what way is this sort of, you know, affecting your debt equity, and, you know, is that sort of off the books in a way?
Absolutely. Thank you, Ramu. For us, like you rightly said, the business model has been very different. Nearly 85% of our client base is international. So quality has been the big focus for us from day one. There was no way that a client abroad would accept any standard, you know, which was below what they were used to. And it doesn't always have to be the most expensive, but it is what they were used to. So trying to do that out of India was, you know, for us a big challenge. We started initially as a company that was outsourcing. So we took a lot of local help. We went to printers here that were already in the business, and we, you know, tried to service these clients. The challenges came because the qualities were compromised. We couldn't have enough, you know, turnaround times were never respected. Also because we are focused on the direct marketing industry. Direct mail, as I think Avijit had alluded to earlier, is very much about turnaround times. So we have to deliver on time every time. And this is Mehul's favorite thing as far as the people in the office are concerned, on time, every time. So having said that, because we were not able to do it, we had to start looking at doing it ourselves. Little by little, we went into a backward integration. We had the business, which was, of course, you know, the fantastic thing. I mean, we were able to travel, we were able to go to shows. People were willing to trust us all these miles away and come here. So we started the backward integration, and that was one of the reasons that we started investing heavily. But fortunately for us, it has paid off. We've continued to add value as far as our clients are concerned. So today, India is not just about printing as far as we're concerned. It's also about data hygiene. It's about teaching them how to make creatives, how to have it delivered. I mean, Mehul and I have, you know, worked so hard at getting partnerships, because the last mile for us is very critical to get the mail delivered. We deliver to about 60 countries worldwide. We print in 15 languages. So, you know, there were a lot of challenges, and obviously it's very easy to kind of just say that, you know, we've done it all, but it wasn't that simple. It's been, you know, a good 16 years doing this for us. But yeah, today we have invested a lot, and it has impacted a little bit on our bottom line. But fortunately for us, because the business keeps coming, we've been traveling a lot more. We've got a fantastic business development team that goes out and, you know, brings the business. And I think this was another point that Avijit had raised earlier in his very rapid presentation, was that, you know, India is becoming a hub, a knowledge base for, you know, clients abroad. So there's a lot of business that is still out there. So I don't think print is dying. You know, everybody's talking about the digital age and all of that and having these panic sessions. Print is definitely not going to die for a long, long time.
Sure. That's what we want to hear here, yes. Before we get on to round two, I know, Iqbal, you've been rubbing your hands in glee, so I'll sort of let you come in with the, you know, first question of round two. Yes, please.
my question is that a lot of our business also comes from the heart. When I say business, I mean investment. We don't generally sit down with complete ROIs. We don't generally sit down with, you know, analyzing a new purchase extremely commercially. We also look at it a little bit with our heart, you know, because there is a certain name that Pragati has, or there's a certain image that Pragati has in terms of certain deliverables. At that point of time, what is the end answer to your investment? Is it driven by the top line, or is it driven by the bottom line? You know that it's going to add an X amount of business, because I know that you are also in the process of buying new machinery, you are replacing your old machinery. Does that sometimes make the bottom line a little shaky, because then you are trying to retain the current business? Does that make a difference?
Actually, going back to the investments which we have just made,
yes,
I asked both my sons, are we going to be in printing or are we not going to be in printing? So they said, yes, of course, we are going to be in printing. So that made it a lot more easier. And both our Komoris were 15 years old. And we wanted to go in for the next one. And we want to be in the business. And a certain set of, one of the verticals is paint business. And that needs that kind of number of colors and all those things. And that's one business which the internet is not going to take away. So it is a good business sense to go into those kind of investments. And I sincerely think in all these 36 years of my printing life, I have not really, as I said, some jobs are done free because we want to support the cause. But otherwise, it's been a bottom line. And I really did not think that this end of March 31st so-and-so year, this is going to be my turnover or that's my target. We never had any targets. Whatever comes.
I'm sorry. When we came for the open house, there was a certain investment you had done, and you were pretty emphatic on that people only see the end, you know, after 4 years or 3 years or 2 years when Pragati starts making money, they see that, okay, they're already into this business. But it's a lot of sweat and blood, you know, and at that point of time, you say that a business actually loses money. So then where is the bottom line there?
It's the point is, any new machine you buy, you have to support it during the crawl and walk phase, till it comes running. So out of the 12, 15 machines we have, most of them are paid for. So the new two machines, they'll be initially, you have to feed them. You have to make sure it's educated. Then only it comes to the employable stage and it can be employed, and then it'll start making money. So there's no two ways about it. Since other machines are making money, as I said, instead of paying income tax, pay this. As I said, so I sincerely think it's always on day one. If somebody else came and invested that kind of money in that kind of machines, and starts to pay from that particular machine, I don't think it's possible.
Yeah, it's not possible.
I don't think so. It's possible. Yeah. So it is always we have to feed it.
Yeah, but then this is in direct contrast to the MOS policy, because when I speak to Mehul Bhai, he says that unless I can run a machine 24 hours, 365 days, I will not invest in a machine. So there are, you know, a bit of a contrast there in terms of investments.
I think if we can get into start the chicken or egg syndrome, I don't think it's ever ending, you know. So I would rather take an egg and hatch it to a turkey rather than wait for the chicken.
Yeah. Thank you, sir. My next question to you is Dharti.
No, I think Mehul had some.
Sorry.
Sorry, carry on. Yeah. Carry on, Iqbal.
Yeah. Dharti, you said that we are concentrating on bottom line, but you also said that we have a very large business development team. So is the brief very clear? I mean, they'll get you tons of business. But then is there a point when you say no? You said no, because the focus is very clear that unless we make this kind of money, we just don't get into it. Because sometimes the business might be, as he said, sometimes you have to let it crawl, you know. So then at that time, how does it work for you?
Actually, that is a challenge, because what happens is sometimes, you know, the salesperson will come back super excited, you know, I've got this big job and it's a great run, it's got volumes, but unfortunately it doesn't contribute to the bottom line. So we have actually trained our people to go out and get jobs that make sense for us. And so it's all about, you know, before they go out there. That used to happen in the beginning, it doesn't happen anymore, because we've invested very heavily in the team. Like you, I think, mentioned earlier, that we do overpay. So we bring in people who understand and speak our language, are able to go out there and convey that to our prospects as well. Did I answer your question?
So you would make it very clear, but you would
absolutely
not really take that kind of
opinion. Yes, that we wouldn't, yeah.
My question is for you, Nilesh.
People are able to hear that.
You were a startup at one point of time. You left a very lucrative job and started a company
from scratch. That was PrintBad. And during your journey from there to by the time being acquired by a NASDAQ-listed company like Vistaprint, okay, there must have been times when you have focused on getting the business in because you've started the business. You know, you were a new entrepreneur. And then over a period of time, maybe because the business was there, the focus has shifted to the bottom line, that now I want to make my returns healthier. So do you believe that there is a life cycle, organization life cycle, which takes you through the seesaw, or is it always a very clear focus that it's bottom line?
You know, part of the entrepreneurial journey, it's a very humbling experience. Yeah. I think you rightly said that I came from a background where it was lucrative, it was high paying. But you know, when I, in retrospect, when people ask me, what would you advise anybody getting into any business? And I say, make sure you pick an industry that you have no knowledge of. And that's a very odd thing to say to somebody, because you know, you would by default think, even my parents would think, well, if you've done finance, why won't you start something in finance? But I think when you go into an industry without any preconceived notions about what the constraints are or what you're going to be restricted by, I think you can fly that much more. Now for me, I didn't know what CMYK was when I started or conceptualized PrintBell. So for me, every day was a learning experience. Every day was an opportunity to go out there and get a job that would help me learn about the business and also keep the company afloat. And since Vistaprint has come on board, I don't think that fabric or that spirit has changed. I think we fundamentally believe that India is at the very beginning of its e-commerce sort of evolution. And you're seeing only now, you know, I know Ashish was here in the morning as well, but if you looked at Book My Show as well, for the first sort of 7 years, the company was at one level, and then there was this boomerang curve. And I think that every industry will go through in e-commerce, and I think when we get to that stage, you're probably right, the focus will change to below the revenue line items a lot more. But I think today we feel that it's such a blue ocean out there, and we have such a massive opportunity that the focus is to get more customers in, and more importantly, get them to come back once they've liked the service and hopefully liked the quality of what we produce.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Jasawala, I have a question for you. Yours is a very large organization, which has a workforce of over 1,000 people, multiple locations. You must be having a broad-based policy that these are the parameters at which we will do the job, and we cannot go below that because of your infrastructural cost, because of your investment in technology, etc. But you are also competing against players who are much smaller. Their infrastructure, their investments, etc., are on a much smaller scale, due to which they are able to offer the same thing to the customer at maybe a much lower price than you are able to offer. What percentage of this business, what percentage of this occurrences is there, and how much business you lose because of this kind of a situation? And if at all you get that business, how do you counter this particular situation?
I'll answer this with the concept of marginal costing. You know, I joined Thomson 6 years ago. And at that time, we have a very solid costing department. So they take the total cost of the organization, divided by the resource, and come up with estimation price. So what it simply means is that if the customer doesn't pay for my cost, I don't take his job. Who's the sufferer? There were several other printers taking away all those jobs. And the result was our capacity utilization was 50-60%. So very quickly I realized that there is something very wrong. I cannot transfer my inefficiencies or my costs built historically and expect the customer to pay for it, while I have very nifty sprinting printer competitors taking away all the business while my capacities and people are sitting idle, partially idle. So we got into the concept that it's better to keep the machine running, utilize the labor, utilize all the management availability, and even if it doesn't recover my full cost. So we went into this concept called marginal costing. Even if I recover a part of my fixed cost, not 100% of my fixed, variable cost has to be recovered. My paper price, my cost of raw material has to be recovered first. Whatever is the difference is the value addition to take care of my fixed cost. Even if it doesn't recover my fixed cost, it's better to keep the machine running and reduce my losses or increase my profit. So we started, you know, getting more and more aggressive on pricing. We realized that it doesn't make sense to have a cutoff price so high that you are completely out of the market. And many customers said, oh, those guys, they are too big. They don't even come to us. Last week I was at another conference, and I must share with you, there was a small printer, and he said, Mr. Jasawala, you don't know me, we know you. Why are you coming and taking away my business? Now, I was sad, but at the same time, I had a glint in my eye, because this is exactly what I wanted my 20 sales guys to go and fight others, not to sit and just service accounts, you know, get big accounts and be happy service. Sales is going and acquiring new customers, go to new geographies, go fight other competitors in the market, take them head on. Don't just complain on price. There is much more customers are willing to pay. So what we've done is that we've now spread ourselves wide. In the last year, when I get information that markets have been flat, we have grown by 24%. And that's because we've been working on this for the last 3 to 4 years, you know, segmenting markets, understanding customer needs, providing generating capabilities to deliver what they need, quality, on-time delivery, prime importance. And those things are now paying off. Even though the market is going down, I think customers are appreciating or perceiving there is something different. And mind you, we are still about the highest in the market. But earlier, the difference was far away. Today, we've come down.
Sir, by that admission, are you now propagating that we should start concentrating on the top line and the bottom line will automatically follow? Because this is the same argument that the big guys give, you know, that our marginal costing suits us and that's why we are not competing. Because when we go in for online, you know, bidding and all that, then sometimes we realize that the big guys are giving some kind of prices which just don't make sense to us. So are they also thinking along the same line that, okay, we have our cost, but in any case, our infrastructure is not paying for itself. So let's go out, look at the marginal costing, try and compete with the smaller guys. That means it's indirectly looking at the top line. The bottom line then becomes secondary. Is that what we are trying to say?
If you don't grow your top line, you'll be dead in no time. Dead in no time. Because your overheads have to keep, at least the inflationary cost increase will hit. People have to be paid increments every year. Your rents, taxes are going up and up. There is, by and large, a cost increase. Yes, we are doing a lot to contain it. But generally, one can expect that your costs will go up. Now, if the cost goes up and you are not going to increase your sales, how will you recover that cost? So growing and growing faster than the increase in cost on the top line is absolutely crucial, failing which the deathbed is already waiting. There's no two things. You cannot get a bottom line unless you are going to grow your top line. There's no two things about it.
Nilesh, would you agree with the same theory that the bottom line and the top line have to be opposing each other, or would you like to? Because we are now having, for the first time, I think probably we are understanding the implications and the impact of the digital world, is that on a panel we have two traditional printers and we have two completely digital printers. So is there a very vast difference in our thought processes?
You know, honestly, as an outsider, when I saw print first, and I was right in Mumbai and Shahnar, I met a lot of people here who've actually taught me a thing or two about printing in this audience as well. I, you know, just coming from a third perspective, I really thought this is a tough business, because I thought the customer has too much information today in terms of what your specific costs are, your input
costs are.
And when you sit down at the negotiation table, it's very hard to negotiate when it's such an open, transparent book. And you've got, like you said, the small guys trying to sometimes even take up a job if it doesn't even pay their variable cost, because they need that cash tomorrow to pay somebody else's salary. So I think it's an increasingly tough business. And that was the reason why I personally thought that you have to think about a model that's somewhat different, that offers the market something different. And when I studied the market, I felt like today, or this is even 5-6 years ago in India, you could go to a relatively good printer who would give you the restrictions on quantities, because you want to do a minimum 1,000 sheet job or a 500 sheet job. Or you go to the local mom and pop who would give you the 1, 2, or 50 sheets that you want, but then you would suffer on quality. So then the idea was, how do you bridge that gap? And once you think about how you bridge that gap, you know, your question's already answered. Because what you're doing then is you're using technology as the intervener. You're still using high-scale printing in the back end. But you're empowering, you know, millions of customers to get that quality at a price which is probably even lower than what they would pay the mom and pop. So I think if you're in that model, which Vistaprint is, you grow top line quickly because you are in a customer wow sort of environment. People love the quality we produce. And your bottom lines are taken care of because of the technology investment that you've done. So I think that's the key difference that we bring with our model.
But is that because it's a product? Because most of the printers here would probably be doing what their customer wants, and probably you would be telling the customer what he wants. Does that make a difference?
You know, this is a great question. And I think even when we initially started, people said, oh, why do you only have three types of papers? Why do you only have X number of sizes that I can print a brochure on? But I think if you see the way it's evolving with the digital and offset sort of cost benefit hitting the curve very quickly, where even a 100-sheet job is very profitable on some of the offset presses or the hybrid presses, I think you are able to offer all that variety. So the initial point that I made, that you're not restricting the customer to pick what he or she wants, but you are also giving them that high quality at a very low price. And I'll give you an example. Vistaprint, when we launched the embroidered t-shirts, this was about 7 years ago, we could do it only on whites, because the number of threads that we had in the backend system, when people upload their images, we didn't have that much of a thread portfolio to be able to render all images that were uploaded. Today, we are offering more than 10 colors. And you know, you can literally upload any logo that you have, and the system is smart enough to understand what colors need to be replaced depending on the base color that you picked for the t-shirt. So I think technology plays a big part in keeping your model intact of the top and bottom line being in a safe zone.
All right. Narendra, sir, for a well-established organization like yours, okay, you were already dealing with the cream of the clients. The market already is aware. The client is aware of Pragati's reputation of being a very quality printer. So there is a given advantage that you already have when you go to the customer, that if you want to go to Pragati, you will get quality, but you may end up paying a little bit more. In that kind of a scenario, you must have your internal benchmarks that any business that we do, it should give us X amount of return minimum. So do you do a kind of an annual review of your client portfolio where you see what kind of returns you are getting from each of the client, or you just broad base your decisions on the overall company's performance and the return and the bottom line?
Actually, since we have a very elaborate MIS system, yeah, whenever we are quoting, we are aware of the situation, how much we are making or what we are making on that particular job. So the point is no review is required at the end of the month, end of the year, end of quarter. And we are quite clear on what exactly is going into that and how much we are making on that. And of course, there are rejections you lose on that job, that's another story. But when we are giving a quotation, we are very clear that this is what you are getting. And of course, there are months which are very heavy months. At that time, you quote slightly higher, or you give a unreasonable delivery schedule, at which time you are politely saying no. Or when it's low season, you just accept it at slightly lower margin and slightly this one, so to keep it going. So it all depends upon how the order book is at that particular time. And based on that, we take it and then
go forward. But you do have a benchmark that this is the least that we should get from that.
Below that, it will not be accepted.
It doesn't matter who the client is.
No, the point is, I sincerely think if, luckily for us, most of the clients whom we are servicing for a very long time, most of the times the job comes, it's printed, invoiced and gone. They never even asked us a quotation. So I think that's the kind of
comfort that they have.
Comfort level. So I sincerely think at which time you are much more careful, so that you should never ever feel, he should not feel that we are taking for a ride. Okay. And that is something that's earned over the years. That like creditworthiness, that's what we earned from him, from the client. And that we have to keep it at all costs and at all times. Okay. So that's how it is.
Okay. I have a question for you, Dharti. And I have inside information about your company. Okay. You have a domestic business and you have an international business. While on the international business, your bottom lines would be protected because A, you're based here. Two, the damn foreign currency is always seeming to benefit you. Okay. But on the domestic sector, I'm sure you have salespeople who keep coming back to you that you are 25% more expensive, 20% more expensive. Nobody is willing. The number of quotations that you issue on domestic jobs and actually the number of jobs that you execute, there's a huge difference. In a scenario like that, A, how do you meet your domestic goals in terms of business volumes and bottom line? And B, how do you keep your sales force, which is handling the domestic market, motivated?
Very simple. You want me to give out the secrets, right?
Yep.
Add value. It's the same way we are treating our international client that we treat our domestic client. by adding value. So we, like I said before, we're not just a printer, certainly not a traditional printer. We're constantly teaching our people to go to a client and add value. I'll give you an example. We had a job with a very large airline to deliver their loyalty kits in India. And it was a very large run. It was a fantastic job, great margins and everything. We get their data. Now, we have a very expert data team. We've got a fantastic data team. They're really trained for many years. They understand international data. They certainly understand Indian data. So they took one look at the data, and they gave us heads up and said, this data is not of good quality. We said, look, these are customers. It's a loyalty kit. So I'm sure the addresses are updated. Turns out they were not. We went back and told the client that your addresses have a problem. They refused to accept at first and said, no, 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 how can that be? These are all members and we've been delivering to them. So we said, okay, we'll send it out. So we printed everything, large run, sent everything out. Sure enough, we had about 30% that came back. 30%. Can you imagine the amount of money that was spent on these loyalty kits? And that's the amount that comes back. Now, this client is going nowhere because we've told them, we'll clean the data for you. We'll make sure that every single loyalty kit is delivered. Add value, find solutions. That's what we tell our team. That's what we've been doing for our international clients. And that's what we're doing for India as well. And this is the advantage of direct mail and direct marketing. It's about getting every single piece of personalized mail delivered to that end customer and getting a response and helping them manage the responses. This is what we've been doing.
Dharti, in our informal chat, you were just mentioning that sometimes it's not worth running a low profit job vis-a-vis a high profit job, you know. Now, in absence of very strong MIS like what Narendraji is perhaps talking about, most printers would generally go by their own calculations and by their own estimations. How easy it is to really distinguish between a high profit and a low profit job, and does it then ultimately impact the bottom line?
It's not very difficult if you have good estimators. And we do have a very professional team. They've understood this business and they're able to, and Mehul personally supervises a lot of these, especially when a client walks in new and it's a little high volume and we have to make these decisions. He's there, he doesn't leave the office.
I'll probably just add to what Iqbal's saying. When this whole idea of, you know, mooting this particular panel came up, as a small exercise, we did a little bit of mapping in 3 or 4 cities. And of course, you know, it's a huge concern in terms of you know, money and what is the sort of value of cash in today's economy. And then we came up with some findings, and it was interesting. We took some, you know, around 47 odd case studies of print firms that are there prevalent in India. We identified that there are about 150 to 200 print firms who are in this tier one category. And therefore, obviously, there's a certain optimum level of performance and there is a certain sort of viability to the balance sheets and so on. And I know that a question that is there amongst a lot of your, you know, with you about these tier one firms. And it was interesting, last week I was in Delhi in Chowri Bazaar and I met somebody who's a Lala, who's basically dealing with paper. And then I started discussing some of these numbers within MIS and, you know, debt, wiping debt out of your balance sheets. And he said, "Dekho bhaiya, hamare industry mein do prakar ke companies hain. एक जो पैसा बनाता है और एक जो बैलेंस शीट में पैसा बनाता है आपको बस डिसाइड करना है कि आप कौन सी कंपनी है द क्वेश्चन आई नो दिस इज समथिंग यू हैव बीन प्रोपगेटिंग फॉर अ लॉन्ग व्हाइल अबाउट एथिक्स इन बिजनेस अबाउट अ सर्टेन क्लीन थिंग इज दैट वेरी टफ एंड इज इट ओनली पॉसिबल फॉर द टॉप 200 और 300 कंपनीज यू नो विच आर ऑब्वियसली ट्राइंग टू वाई फॉर सर्टेन काइंड ऑफ कॉर्पोरेट्स यू नो रिकॉग्निशन ब्रांडिंग एक्सेट्रा एंड इज इट डिफिकल्ट फॉर अ वास्ट क्रॉस सेक्शन ऑफ प्रिंटर्स
आई सिंसियरली थिंक वंस यू कम टू अ सर्टेन लेवल It is it's only right to be on the right side of the law because it's very difficult to manage 1,500 people working without any proper MIS. And the point is, I'm not worried about the 34 paisa I'm paying the government. I'm worried about my 66 paisa. So I sincerely think, looking at that, it has to be ethical. And from what Dharti was saying, I endorse her point. We do printing for breakfast, lunch, and dinner, and our clients do their job. And we know a lot more about printing. And so if we add value to their jobs, making sure, so let them take the credit, but let us get the orders.
Sure.
That's what it is.
Mr. Jasawala, just a supplementary, and then we'll open it. You know, I mean, a similar boat for you. I also know that you have a lot of, especially publishing in certain segments, magazines, where they're on annual contracts. And with paper prices, input prices going all over the place, you know, sometimes, I mean, how do you redraw these contracts? Or then again, there are tweaks within the system? Because obviously, costings go for a six after that.
Yeah.
We have at least 70 to 80% of our business is long-term annual contract. So we have a safety on our side. As long as the cost of paper and inputs go up by 4 to 5% a year, it's fine. And that's how it happened for years. In the current year, you all must be aware, paper prices have gone up from April till date by 20 to 25%. In Haryana, where our factory is, energy cost, HSEB, unit cost has gone up by 23%. Diesel prices have just shot through the roof over the last 18 months. And in such a situation, people like us who have long-term contracts, annual contracts, we faced a real severe problem. So we've learned now to correct our agreements or to have clear-cut understanding that if input prices go up beyond a certain percent, then we will have to come back to the publisher, customer, and ask for a correction.
Sure.
We already have the same thing in exports, you know, where we say that we have long-term contracts with publishers. If the dollar-rupee parity goes beyond 4%, one way or the other, it's a transparent understanding. So we are bringing that experience into Indian publishers. And of course, it was very, very bad last year.
Right.
It was very difficult because no publisher wants to give away anything. But I think there is trust developed that they understand our ethics. We are transparently showing information and data to them. And therefore, we meet somewhere in between. They may not recover pay back our entire cost increase, but much of it was.
Sure. Yeah. Thank you. We'll open this to the audience. I know there's a question from Tushar Bhotika to start to lead the thing, if he's there in the. Yeah, okay, super. And those of you who have questions, thanks, subsequently, ma'am. Just please raise your hand, announce your name, and.
And please also let us know who you are addressing your question to from amongst our panel. Okay?
Before I ask my question, I'd just like to quote one of the greatest tech icons of present day, Steve Jobs. May his soul rest in peace. He said, take care of the top line and the bottom line will follow. Now, I don't know how far that is true. I would like to ask two questions. One is on behalf of the many small printers who are here, predominantly. When you're a small printer, it's the profits do matter, because without that, he will probably not survive to live another day. Now, when you're looking only at the top line, and in fact, from what I could understand from the panelists here, they're mostly talking about the bottom line, and there are some who also believe in the top line. Now, when you're only looking at the top line, and you sacrifice your margins, you may not live to live another day. So is looking only at the top line, as Steve Jobs says, the right strategy for a small printer, or he has to look at his bottom line first? That's my question number one. And the second question is, with due respect to all of you, you're all 100 crore plus companies, as I understand. We talk of the top line and the bottom line, but somewhere in between is the middle line, or the number of lines, you know, which make up the bottom line. So how do you people take care of your middle lines, the costs, I mean?
I just want to clarify one thing. I did emphasize that top line is important. It doesn't mean that my eyesight is not on the bottom line. At the board level, at the promoters level, if they are not making money, they are not happy. So there's no question of not looking on the bottom line. But you can keep looking on the bottom line, nothing will happen unless the drivers of that bottom line are going to be acted by us. So the top line is a driver of the bottom line. As far as the middle lines are concerned, I think our attention is very sharply focused on that too. We have to, there are only two lines, a revenue line and a cost line. We have to keep our costs under control, better still cut it. Cut it if you can, particularly fixed costs. And the other thing I want to clarify, there is no mad scramble for pricing. If I've given that impression, I'm sorry, for cutting price. No way. We have a Lakshman Rekha. No job will ever be taken below that Lakshman Rekha. So things are, checks and balances are there. But when the question is put top or bottom, very clearly the top will drive the bottom.
Nilesh, would you want to add to that? I mean, you have had experience with a lot of small printers in Shahnaar and A to Z and so on. I mean, in terms of finance processes, management processes, where do you think they're getting it right, and obviously, where, what do they need to do to improve from, you know, your perspective?
I think you've got to be very clear about your value proposition. So what do you stand for the customer? Are you going to compete on price? Are you going to compete on delivery? Are you going to compete on quality? Now, unfortunately, in business, especially if you're a small printer who's trying to make it big, you will have to meet all those requirements to get the customer in the door. But I've seen a lot of times where there is this excitement and urge to keep the machine going. There is this concept of, oh, I have my machines running 24 hours a day. And then the focus shifts quickly on what volumes are we producing and what the throughput out of the plant is or of the machine is. I think you somewhere have to keep that conscious hat on and make sure that you are doing this diligent assessment of either your customers, what you're providing to them, what can you do smartly to become a USP for some customer versus the other. And you know, it relates to the top and bottom line that you mentioned. If you do an analysis, and I did this as an investor, of most companies in the world across industry, you would have most of them end up in a net margin of between 5% and 10%. This would be 90% of the normal bell curve would end up in that. Now, it all depends on, if you're a business with a 65% gross margin business like we are, our marketing costs and our technology costs are way too high for us to still end up at that level. If you're a printer who's not investing that much in technology, maybe your depreciation cost is a lot higher because of the investments you've made. So I think if you have to really look at the middle layer as what your value proposition is, and what is it that's going to have a customer come back to you. I mean, I really like the point about when a customer comes in, there's not even a quote negotiation, there is an invoicing and then the payment comes through. We like to follow that logic as well. We focus a lot on how many customers are coming back to us as opposed to what they're spending in their first purchase. And Ramu, you know, you mentioned the 5,000 rupees. If you look at our customers over a two-year period, actually 80% of them end up spending 5x of that.
Right.
So the new customers are spending a lot less, but because we have a value proposition right, over a two-year period, it pans out. And therefore, you have to have that long-term view as well while you're doing the daily diligence of your cost and operations.
Sure. I'd like to take one line you said. Profits do matter for a small printer. Profits do matter, period. For small, big, medium, everybody. You know, without it, nobody can run.
Any more questions, please? Yeah. Amit Shah from Spectrum Scan.
Sir, do you invest in R&D in terms of, once you say you have to decide a new machine, it's a very simple buy it old to new. When we are talking about a new vertical by itself, in printing or whatever, extension of printing, pre-press, post-press, while press. You invest in R&D, A, and it's a constant feature for you to look into market first or you want to develop the market afterwards?
Actually, both are correct. Some, because the market demands or something, we look at an opportunity, we go for it. Number two, again, not looking at the chicken, we look at the egg first, and then there are many, many technologies we first bought in, tested, and then put it into the market. The problem is, you will dream of Deepika Padukone or Hrithik Roshan only if you know they exist. If you don't know they exist, they won't come in your dreams. So similarly, I have to make sure that make these things available to the designers and to the people who are looking at designing things, that these things are available. Then when they're available, they start dreaming about it, and it's our job to turn their dreams into reality. So it is a constant process. We have to keep on going. Whether now we are doing in boxes or whether we are doing in something else, everywhere R&D is a way of life. And I said, tomorrow you don't want to go onto the deathbed, you bloody well be in the R&D labs, always.
Right. Yes. Bimal, you have a question. Bimal Mehta from Vakils.
Question for you. Do you advocate for a small printer more strategic alliances and sharing of resources for them to actually, you know, use that as a medium to compete with big guys like you?
Actually, I am not too sure about it. The point is, I sincerely think from the time we were doing photo typesetting in 1979, and I got five or six people who were doing similar job to do something like that, till today, we all come, eat, drink, and go away, and then do exactly what we want. So that one hobby is not really coming in the system, and I am not sure, maybe because they don't trust each other, or whatever reason, it's not happening. And I tried many times, I failed.
You were talking about the lifetime creditworthiness.
Like, I give you full marks on that. Mm-hmm. But you talked about a differential pricing. Fast. If you're busy, your work schedule is heavy. You just to turn out, turn above, or wrong, sorry, to turn a job away, you would give a high pricing.
No, but I quote more time.
Yeah, so that you quote more time or more pricing?
More time. Instead of they want 1 week, I'm sorry, I can't do it in 1 week.
It's only the delivery time.
Yes, delivery time.
The question that I have for Mr. Jasawala is, you were talking about 24% growth. Now, the 24% growth comes from what ratio? Comes from the commercial printing, what comes from your publishing business? Publishing, again, I would like you to, if possible, give the difference between in-house publishing and external.
You said publishing.
Yeah.
I am not talking about growth in publishing from my side, only commercial printing.
Hi, good afternoon. I'm Jit from Singapore. I have a question to Nilesh. I've been following Vistas Print's development. And in the new business model, Vistaprint has been losing money for quite a while. And if I didn't recall wrongly, it lost like 16 million before when it got listed. But then after that, 2006 onwards, the profit just keep increasing and even through the crisis. So, I mean, for your business and Printbell, how did it go? Do you look at the bottom line when you first, or how do you actually structure that? Because when you look at like the Amazon, the Facebook and all this, you know, they don't look at the bottom line first. They just go for a top line and eventually then the bottom line comes. So for the disruptive model, do you follow the traditional model? Thank you.
Actually, the short answer is depends on your investor. If you've got a venture capitalist or a private equity firm who's got the vision, I think that significantly impacts the journey you want to embark for the business. I think, you know, when Vistaprint started, or even when Printbell started, this model would work at scale. I think that was a given. Because what you're doing is you're basically assembling a lot of customers for the same volume of revenue that you would at a typical print job, for example. So unless you get that scale of customers coming through your funnel, your viability becomes that much more difficult. And going back to the chicken and egg, I think Vistaprint followed the model of investing up front in a lot of its technologies. I mean, even today, if we are a billion-dollar company globally, we spend more than 10% on technology. And that's a big sum. Somebody asked the question on R&D. So a lot of that goes in R&D. A lot of the systems that we come out with are very proprietary to us. So how we print on USB sticks or how we print on T-shirts, for example, are very unique to us. So you've got to have that gestation period be validated for the business, and you've got to have that vision and belief that it will pan out at scale. Now, fortunately, it's worked for us. There are several examples where it hasn't worked, and you end up in a situation where your costs are very lopsided. I think, thankfully for us, the limited history we've seen with Printbell and now going into Vistaprint, we feel very confident that over time, this will be a very sustainable, profitable business, even though it requires the upfront investments for you to build that scale.
As far as I know, Pragati, you most equipment having Asian equipments or Japanese equipment, whereas rest of the most of the Western people, West side people, have European equipment. So is that a secret of your...
No, at one time when we wanted to buy new equipment, there was Czechoslovakian equipment, there was Japanese equipment, and there was German equipment. We couldn't afford the German. It was too expensive. So we went for, first time we went for a Japanese machine called Shinohara, and we were very happy with it. Then we moved on to Komori. And I've been a happy user, so I felt no reason that I should change my machine. And at the same time, I must tell you in the same breath that there is no question of any bad machine or any good machine. All are good. So what works for you, what works, what finances works for you, how the people are there servicing your equipment, and your own happiness in running that machine. That will, so every machine is good. For us, this worked. And somewhere along the line, since we were going that, the cutting machine, the folding machine, the binding machine, everything came from there. And as I said, we are a happy user, and if I have a choice, I buy the same equipment again.
Sure. I think one final question, and we are done with Nilesh, is that I know you're an former investment banker, and this is a question I think everybody in the print industry wants to know. If you were to punt on the print industry now, would you you know, invest in print? Is there valuation there?
If
about 5 years late asking me that question. I've already done that. I think, look, you in any industry, I don't think this is true for print, if you look at any successful model out there across industries, models that have been successful have been the ones that have been disruptive. You look at, you know, somebody spoke about Apple. I mean, when Apple came out with the iPod or the iPhone, it was truly disruptive. And I think a lot of people get tangled in the distinction between whether their business represents a disruptive process or is it actually a disruptive product. So you might actually do something differently and you might call yourself disruptive, but if you're producing the same thing at the end of the day, you're not going to create that customer market space for yourself. So I think ask that question very deeply within you, whether what you're doing is truly disruptive from a product perspective. When you use a process change, there, I think it's a matter of time before others start replicating you. And therefore, I think that distinction has to be very clear.
Sure. All right, thank you. I think that's sort of done. All the panelists are available post this session for tea and coffee break.